So if you'll permit me, in just 2 minutes, I'll provide some kind of a factual context to that. Now, it appears to be in modern day India is a very good place for women. Enrollment in primary education is almost 100%. Higher education has gone from 7.5 to 20% in over a decade. So there seems to be a lot. There are 15% of women pilots, which is much higher than the global rate, which is about 8 or 9%. You can hear, see and hear women pilots everywhere. So it seems like a good time. What is unfortunately happening is that women's participation in the workforce is at all-time low. It's about 27%, and this has fallen from 35% in over 2 decades. And the highest number of the women who are out of work most are those who are illiterate, at one end of the spectrum, but even higher, and the highest in fact, are graduates. 68% of graduates do not work at all. Now, clearly something is going on here. Where are these women? What are they doing? It's not entirely clear. But I think a lot of that has to do with patriarchy and the way it's playing itself out, whether it's benign or whether it's otherwise. So I'll leave you with that and hope you can take it from there.
Can I add some facts and figures to the ones you just said? They're from the top of my head. But even the system, the government as it were, has some very interesting and very gender-friendly rules. There's a very long maternity leave. There is also a paternity leave in India for government servants. There is even a miscarriage leave, which is very rare. A woman has time to recover and come back to work. Even in the US, you know, the notion of maternity leave is really missing. So the idea is women, when they reach childbearing age, should go back and raise a family, and there is no certainty that a job is waiting. That doesn't happen today. The UGC even has a provision of a 2-year leave, which a man or a woman can take right up to their child is 18. So let's say you have a child taking a 10th board exam or a 12th board exam or any exam for that matter. The government allows you to take that much leave. You can clock it, you can break it, you can do what you wish with it. The provisions are there. So, you know, we love to run down institutions and our own states and administration and so on. But every now and then the government surprises you when it throws something like this at you. And we don't have a gender ceiling, I mean, in real terms. It might be in our head, it might be in our society, it might be in our family, it might be in our immediate context. But think of it, we've had a woman prime minister, we've had women joining. The High Court has given a very good judgment about women being allowed on ships or being allowed to fly aircraft, fighter craft. So every now and then the system surprises us. My big worry and sadness is that we are not pushing the envelope. So let's take this from here.
I don't know whether having it in letter is equal to having it in practice. Because I mean, I have worked with organizations that are not government related, and I've seen how I mean, I have fought because I've fought for women's causes, and I had to fight for colleagues who had miscarriages and were not given maternity leave because it was a private organization. I've seen women getting pregnant and losing out on, not in the editorial section, but in the section where you have PRAs for the money you bring in, women's response and advertising. I've seen women getting pregnant and losing out on promotions. Because you will be busy with your child, you're giving your time for your child, but that woman feels cheated. So I don't know whether having a wonderful law that lets you take leave for up to 2 years really is put into practice. I don't know anyone. Do you know anyone who's taken?
I know I took 16 weeks miscarriage leave, which my administrative officer pointed out to me and said, here's a provision, the way to come back healthy. So I'm saying the provisions are there, maybe we're not aware of them, maybe we don't utilize them. But I'm not making this out to be a general thing that we have a very non-patriarchal state. I just wanted to add to the figures you were giving to sort of say that we do also have this.
No, so I think put together, whatever both of you are saying, it seems to be that there are certain clear enabling provisions. That there are people like who have fought for these things, the laws are there, etc. But at the end of the day, we're left with these figures, and we're left with these women who are dropping out of the workforce, even as they are getting educated. Which brings us to the point that there is clearly then another factor at work, and that is patriarchy and men and how the society is formed. One of the reasons that some researchers have found for this low workforce participation is that as cities grow, if women have to travel further distances, if they don't get clearance from their fathers or their husbands, they tend to drop out of jobs and things like this. But so obviously there is clearly something. Men, families are allowing women to go out, get educated, get more educated than they ever did. But is something pulling them back at some point? Are there red lines, different red lines?
The fact that you're using the word allow itself is is completely
factual, yes.
Yeah. And I also think there's also the double pressure on a lot of women that they have to now do double jobs. If they take a job, they also have to come home and be a full-time wife and mother. Very few men, at least of the earlier generation, thought it was worth their while to help to even lift a glass of water from one table and put it to another. And women said, what should we do? You know, if it's his job, if he wants to be the boss, then let him bring in the money. I think that's one more reason. One of the reasons some women choose not to work.
That's entirely correct, because what tends to happen, I find, is that in Bangalore, where I live, the IT sector is a very good example of supposedly equal opportunity for women, because at entry level, now it's gone up from 48 to 51% of everyone entering the IT sector are women. In 7 years, that falls to about 15%, and in about 12, 13 years, it's down to 7-8%. Only 7-8% are left. So what's happening? So there's one woman who told me, I was trying to, you know, explore this, what's happening. She said the difference is that we have to do our jobs, as you said, and we have to put hot chapatis on the table. And that hot chapatis phenomena appears to persist in India. And that, I think, is where this whole question of benign patriarchy comes in. You were mentioning about advertisements.
Yeah.
Let's talk a bit about the kind of imagery that surrounds us all over.
Yeah. If you recall an ad that came in the 80s, you know, the boy from jockeys. So there was a man bare-chested in a white-front jockey, and there was this very scantily clad woman who's not required really to be in that frame. But the idea was that there is this man bare-chested and strong and all of that, protecting her. The ad was for undergarments. That woman was just not required to be there. So these images that we start, in our public perception, and advertisements, films, all of that, they perpetuate that. This business of hot rotis, you know. So you have this immaculately made up woman who's seen moving seamlessly from one frame to the other. She's a banker, or she's some hot shot, seemingly, you know, an exec type. And then she moves seamlessly into the kitchen. And there she is making hot rotis and all of that. So we are using all of these images to put up a notion of perfection. I know young women who are a very successful lawyer that I can. A woman who's working in the airline industry gets married to a pilot. The pilot doesn't leave her job. This young woman who works as an aerostat chooses to leave her job. Not because, as she said, what allow her to use. Her in-laws were allowing her to work. She chose not to. So whether it's hard roti or whether it's keeping a good house or it's being a perfect hostess or in the years ahead being a good mother, all of these are notions I think that we inflict on ourselves. So let women also question how they see themselves in what is essentially a patriarchy world. Let us question patriarchy. I see patriarchy as a status quo. To me, anything that is status quoist is in a sense patriarchy. What stems from it?
Add to that. We did an Oil India survey to do an article. But what happens in families when women are more powerful in the workplace than their husbands? You know, sometimes in similar jobs or in completely different jobs, they bring in more money. And it was a huge issue with some men that their wife was seen as a role model, was seen as someone wielding a lot of power, while they were just men in the workplace. And there were, of course, a lot of men who were proud of their wives and said, we are happy. I mean, they said things like, we are happy she's who she is, and we don't mind at all that the more money is coming in, because I am of course also using that money. But that was one point of view. But most women said, there was this high court judge who told us this very telling story. He said, in court I am like sitting there and holding people's destinies in my hand. People stand up and enter the room, but the first thing I do when I go home, as well as the government servant, much lower level. Since the moment I go home, the first thing I do when my husband comes home, I bring his chappals and put them ready. So it's a tokenism to say, in the house you're the boss, no kindness. So it continues, you know, these role playing traps continue, because women also allow it. They want peace. They want, she doesn't want to come home and have that taunting her, saying, I judge madam, aapne kya kar diya court mein or something. So I think, but men are changing.
Men are changing.
Men are changing.
Let's take it from there. How are men changing? Are they changing? You said your husband washes all the toilets at home,
yes.
Rakhshanda.
Yeah.
So that's a good start, certainly.
I didn't go into the kitchen earlier. Once or twice when I was to cook, and after coming from work, and he felt sad about it. He'd see curtains up. I don't want the neighbors to see him in the kitchen. But now he cooks, right? He cooks, he will, if necessary, the maid hasn't come in, the house is dusty, I pick up the jhadu, he will take up the pocha. So, I mean, it's amazing. And my son, I think, is the model young Indian man, because his wife is globetrotting. She's chasing a corporate career. So he said, I'm freelancing. I can stay back at home. And he's learned amazing international dishes. He enjoys cooking. He is there for the doctor. And he takes her to school, brings her back. He does his work when he can. And he, of course, we all did this. But he is not ashamed of saying, I work from home. I work when I need to. Because she's the one who's pushing her career, and I want her to go where she needs to. I think men are changing.
I think one of the keys in getting men to change is actually women, in the way they raise boys specifically. This whole Mera Raja Beta syndrome, I think, afflicts Indian families in some form.
Even the toys that you buy for a boy and a girl, it starts from there, isn't it? You buy a boy, you buy a stuffed toy or a soft toy or a doll for a girl, you buy a mechanic set or a train, all of those things. So I think it starts very early, even the blue and the pink, you know, from the nursery, you paint the nursery wall, or the nursing home, which the infant is born, will be wrapped in a pink blanket. All of these, I think it starts so early, and it starts in a benign way. Nothing wrong with pink, nothing wrong with blue. They're colors. But I think it's this one thing that leads to the other. It's the pile of images, it's the pile of stereotypes, the kind of.
I completely agree. When I go to shop for pajamas for my 7-year-old daughter, first time I met him, they said, boy or a girl? I said, that time she's 4 years old, how does it matter? There's no separate section and different parts of the shop. So I went and said, the girls' section is quite ridiculous. So I only would ever bought her from the boys' section. There are other things that in a school, she's very physical and plays a lot of sport and used to play football. Now I find in the last 3 or 4 months, suddenly I found that the football has stopped because the girls have somehow gravitated to one end and they're playing sister-sister. And this girl was playing football, you know, and is a very good swimmer. It's now reduced to playing sister-sister. And I don't know the way out of it, frankly.
And you must be the only football father. They're mostly football moms. Moms who brought their boys for practice, for example.
Yeah, well,
it's
not
yes.
The moms as they call. No, that's true, because I am part of two mommies groups, so to say I am the only father, because there are no other fathers on that mommies group. But I enjoy it, you know, this bright, intelligent
women
hanging out with. This is a good life. I don't have a problem with that whatsoever. Since my daughter's been young, I've been hanging out with all these women. And the thing is, hanging out with them, I find this actually so much more inspiring than hanging out with
the
fathers. Yes.
Gadgets and cars and all the rest of it.
Exactly, and their sons talk exactly like that. Oh, that's a Mercedes, that's a BMW, who the hell cares? But because many of these women are doing it all. Many of them, almost all are working women, yet they're raising their kids and they're showing up at these ridiculous birthday parties that we're all forced into. Yet they're there, while fathers are doing, I don't know exactly what they're doing that is so different from them. And when I had applied for paternity leave, because I stayed at home for the first 6 years of my daughter, my wife worked, she was not the type to stay at home. So I said, you should work, I will stay at home. So I applied for paternity leave. So they said that, we don't have a provision for paternity leave. I said, that's impossible, you have to give me. They said, okay, as a special case, we'll give you 3 weeks. The first they said 3 days, then they increased it to 3 weeks. And that was about it. So finally I quit my job.
But it's really common to see girls playing football now these players. Schools are encouraging in basketball, football, girls are allowed to play. There are teams, there are matches happening, and they play against the boys and sometimes win. It's good fun. But I also have another problem that I used to be a tomboy, terrible tomboy, playing top of trees all the time. And constantly a girl is told, you fall down, you break something, you'll marry you. So again, this whole thing, a whole generation grew up thinking marriage was the be-all and end-all, not realizing that that was the beginning of another long story of other things, that you can't do. So what do you think of that?
In sport, there's a lot that is changing, because you see our boxers, female boxers, etc., on two ends of the country, from Haryana and in Manipur. This has now become systemic. The wrestlers, for example, the women wrestlers, And all the films that have been made about them and all the battles that they have fought, it isn't that anything is changing overnight, but I think a start has been made. But is that patriarchy so overwhelming that we cannot push through? I can't discern this from outside. So what do you think from your experiences? Where exactly does it stand?
I don't really talk about numbers as a feeling. I think they are one-offs rather than emblematic or representative, because they were so inspiring that movies were made out of them. But it's not as though a lot of women are like this. So I don't really want to talk about that. I don't know much about it. I don't know how many women wrestlers there are.
Quite a few have come up.
Okay, I'll take your word for it. But the view from inside as I see it, may I share what I grew up with a very sort of enlightened, liberal father, with three daughters, who he made no difference with his son. My brother still thinks that there was reverse discrimination in our house. Girls could do no wrong and he was being picked on all the time. Having said that, we had this rule in our home. I grew up in a time when there were no cell phones and we sort of went out in the day and our parents had no way of keeping track on us and they sort of relied on good luck and a lot about who's keeping an eye on us. So when we came back home, there was the understanding was that we'd be home by Maghrib. Maghrib is sunset time. Now, why Maghrib? It applied to the three of us, the girls. My brother could pretty much be back whenever it suited him. But the girls, and this is coming from a good father, a father who was kind, who was considerate, who was very trusting, who sort of gave us all the freedom. But somewhere there was this notion, living in Delhi, it's not a safe place, do what you want, but be home by sunset. Now I see Abu as an example of a benign patriarch, in the sense that obviously he could go out, fix the world, he could make the world a good place for his daughters to be out and after sunset. So what he wanted for his daughters was to be safe. So if he went home by sunset, it's not as though Abu threw a tantrum or shouted or ranted, but we would come back and find him walking up and down the lane. I see that as benign. I see other examples of it. For example, Rakhshanda, a writing, a very progressive writer, a good writer, a feminist writer, writing the introduction to Ismat Chuktai's collection of short stories in the year 1950-something, also a feminist writer, comes up to this remarkable sentence. He says, her writings are as complicated as a woman's heart. What is complicated as a woman? What is feminine? Somebody here lost it. For a man, why? Anatomically, there is no difference between a man's heart and a woman's heart. Anatomically, there are the differences. A penis is wider than a man's. She has
the heart there is no difference. And yet there are these stereotypes. The best of us, the finest of men, make this. You know, a woman is required to be tempting and kind and nurturing. And her heart is supposed to be complicated. Why? Tell me someone.
The roles that are forced on us, which have evolved, perhaps have something to do with it. I mean, they say that man's greatest invention was fire, and the second thing was cooking, and that is what really changed civilization. And that cooking, if you say, when did that happen? 2 million years ago or something. When man discovered cooking, led to a huge difference in the way society was organized, but that's when the split began between men and women, and those roles were
set. The hunter-gatherers.
The hunter-gatherers, exactly. And the ones who did the caring, and that's when it split and it stayed. So at this point of time, if you permit me, what I see as happening is that we are actually at a very critical inflection point. For the first time in 2 million years, that role, that traditional role that fell into place then, is now actually being challenged.
That's why they can't understand the woman.
Find out.
They are wondering what the hell happened. You know, why is she suddenly thinking out of the box? Why is she suddenly in our turf? And why is she trying to go walk shoulder to shoulder with us, fly above our horizons? I think that's why they say we can't understand the woman's heart.
But except, at least in this context, the foreword by Christian gender, it's actually been said, offered as a compliment. Her stories are as complicated as a woman's heart. You know, her stories are actually not complicated at all. They're about women, going about their business, doing things, you know. But for a man, all of this seems very complicated. I'll again come back to this month because I've been reading and writing and thinking about her, a feminist writer. Sort of liberal man, Fairs and Affairs, also writing a long essay on her, talks about the sex appeal in her life. Now this business of sex appeal is a very mysterious thing for men. What sex appeal? She's writing about women. What sex appeal? I'm not sure. You know? So these are things we need to question. Why does a man see sex appeal in a writing? But I don't. You know? So it's the perspective.
I want to go back to something that was being discussed a bit earlier, that, you know, you could have a benign father who believes, I'm one of two sisters, and I was born 14 years after my parents got married. And my father was the son, the only son of a zamindar, who kept saying, marry again, his whole family said, marry again, this woman is barren, she's not going to give us an heir. You know, it's very important to have an heir to carry the family name forward, but my father said no. And finally, after 14 years of whatever, I was born, and they said, oh, no, not a girl. So they said, see, we told you, you should have divorced her, you should have married again. At which point my father said, forget it, I don't want you, Zameen, I don't want you. I'll come to do your last rites when you die, and he took a transfer and went off to Lahore of all places. So he brought us up to believe that we were equal to any boy. You think you're as good as any son, I don't miss a son for something you tell us often. So we grew up imagining that we were free. Of course, my mother was strict, she was worried about our getting married at some point. So she would hold back and he would let us fly. And then I remember one incident, which I would like to say, that society wounds you back. Society doesn't see you with the eyes of your father, or from a benign man's eyes. I was in us, which was where I belonged, and we were at the wedding, and we had gone for some ceremony, and the house where we had to go back was about a kilometer away. So the women all got into their cars and went off, and I said, I'm going to walk with my cousin brothers, and I was walking with them in the night, and next morning my mother said, no more walking in the streets in the night, because your uncle says, it's not nice, somebody will see her with the boys, and then she'll get a bad reputation. I said, they're my brothers. I mean, what the hell? She says, no, but how do they know they're your brothers? So you're not going to be seen on the street with men. I said, no. So, you know, I fought it, but I had to say yes. So it doesn't matter if you are nurtured by benign parents or by benign siblings. The fact is society includes you.
That's a good point, because for example, I'm just thinking about my father. When I was born, I'm the oldest of two brothers. When I was born, he was apparently disappointed. So the nurse came to him and said, no sir, it's a boy. He said, yes, I wanted a girl. And then he waited for the next, he got a boy again. So finally he named his house after the name he had preserved for the daughter he never had, and then he adopted one of my cousins, kind of said whether she liked it or not, you're mine, now my daughter. But the point is, you know, if there's this kind of a seminal change that's taking place, if we talk of that 2 million year old change that's taking place, what is it that now requires to be pushed? Is it basically the way that men adapt their roles? I'll give one example. You know, when I wrote this dubious book on men cooking some years ago, and after that I should go to some companies and do these corporate talks on why it is important for men to get into the kitchen and how that can affect your productivity and national productivity as well. When I used to go to these companies, there used to be a commonality. There would be, I find that the women would be kind of nodding the head and be seriously listening, and men, especially the ones who see them, would start tittering. And at the end of it, of course, say, oh, this is, you know, very interesting, very funny, etc., and make jokes about it. And at the end of it, it would always be women who would come around and ask for advice. What do you think we should do? I said, I'm not sure what you can do. And at one point, there were these journalists, this was in Hyderabad, who came to me, who were filming the whole thing at book launch. They said, so you know, all this that you're saying is really good, but Telugu, you know, men are different. They will not, and everywhere I found the same thing. They said, Telugu men are different. They will want us to cook as well. So I said, but you're out working here. It's you who have to fight back. How do you make that that push forward, that thing can push patriarchy back, benign or otherwise? What is it that you need to do?
I mean, I give another example. When I was younger and I used to want to wear jeans, my mother would say, no, not now. After you marry, you wear what you want. Now you dress like a girl. You know, you may climb trees, but climb them in, you know, Kagra or Pavada or whatever I was wearing. So then I got married and I said, now it was the time of bell bottoms. So I said, I want to wear bell bottoms at the tops. My husband said, my father may not like. I said, can I just buy them and when we go out of town, I'll wear it. He said, yeah, buy one pair. So I bought it. And then one day I said, what the bloody hell, why can't I wear what I want? I was told after marriage I can wear what I want. So I put on these clothes and I went to school in Kalka, my father went out, who was a benign person. So I said, Babuji, can I wear this? He said, why not? I said, no, because your son thinks you may not like. So he said, well, I see you're covered from head to toe, I don't see anything wrong. So I stood there that evening and I said, Baba, this is fine. So after that, it was fine. So, and I afterwards thought about it, if I said I will wear, it would have become a big issue. But if you can work around it, I don't know if you want to call it manipulation, but it isn't. Just work around the issue, things get solved.
Rakhshanda, should this be benign to push back?
No, I don't. It should be clever though. It should be pragmatic occasionally, yes. I come back to this business of being out in the night. Right? It's because I live in Delhi and it truly is not very safe. It's not Bombay, for example. If I am two grown up girls and this is a major concern which my parents face, which I face right today, this business of safety. It's all very well to say that you know, I want to be out in the night and I want to live my life. But you have to be safe. Nirbhaya happened in Delhi, and I'm sure many of us would go. A brutal, brutal rape happened. Yeah? There's a kind of trauma, a kind of. It just sort of. I think it was a defining moment for many men as well. That this sort of happened is happening. Why? Because they just found a victim, found a girl alone with a man, they got rid of the man, faster than her. So Nirbhaya is never far from her. And the fact that people gave her that name, I mean, just pause for a minute and think. Her name was Jyoti Singh. The media gave her the name Nirbhaya, meaning fearless. She must have been terrified.
it must have been the most traumatic time of her life, and yet the media gave the name Nirbhaya, the fearless one. We still refer to her as that. Now, a little bit of fear. So I don't know about benign, about pushing back benign patriarchy, being benign, I don't know. But I certainly know that as a mother of two girls now, I talk of pushing back benign patriarchy, cleverness, pragmatism, a good sound head on your shoulders. And of course, standing your ground in many, very many ways.
I don't think safety is at all
negotiable.
No, it's not negotiable, and it's not anything to do with patriarchy, because a mother will tell you first, even before the father says, come back before her. I mean, a mother's not going to say, hey, give her a freedom, let her go where she wants. She's the first person because she is more aware of what can happen to you than your mother is.
But curfew time can be very restrictive. In a home with a boy and a girl, you see the disparity. You see the disparity in the way you're raising a boy and a girl. The curfew time applies to a girl, it does not apply to a boy.
But if it is explained, I think safety has to also be understood by each person. How much can you push that horizon? How much of risk can you take? Has to be every single, like I drive home at 1:32 in the night in Bombay, I don't think I do the same thing in Delhi. You know, when I used to go for the fashion weeks and I didn't have my own car, I would hang on to the first person and say, drop me back.
We have 10 minutes left. We open it up for questions. Yes, Annie, you were supposed to be here.
You were supposed to be here. So you speak for 10 minutes now.
Yeah.
So I walked in like 2 minutes late. I don't know if this question already has been addressed
right
at the beginning. But what are we saying benign in opposition to? Is it a virulent, cancerous patriarchy? How are we positioning the patriarchy? I think that is the first question that one needs to ask of ourselves and, of course, of the panelists. And I think the second question is, in my mind, comes off this book that I read by Suniti Namjoshi. I don't know if you're familiar with her work. She's a feminist writer and not published a lot in India now, but she's based abroad, I think, and she has been published significantly in the 80s. And somehow her work has just somehow disappeared from the bookshelves. She wrote this book called The Mothers of Miami, which is a feminist dystopia about a matriarchy which has turned dystopic. The reason I bring that book up and the idea of, I mean, in a sense, we are living in a dystopia when we speak of the patriarchy and of living the dystopia. But can we imagine a matriarchy which is somehow, can a matriarchy also be benign versus cancerous? And what are your views on this?
I think women can be very nasty. Very nasty. Nastier. Because they say it happened to me, why shouldn't it happen to you? I mean, the entire mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, line of abuse continues because of this. But I think the working woman, when women went into the workplace, I've met people who tell me my best friend is my mother-in-law, because she has understood the pressures on a woman when she goes out to work, and therefore is much more kind to the daughter-in-law. It's no longer a power struggle because they're suddenly economically. But yes, women can ask. So I don't think, I mean, they take the example of the men in the family and just continue it as one way of showing. But a lot of women in the workplace do that. They become more male than the male bosses and abuse their juniors.
Annie, I don't know if you were here when I said that I understand patriarchy as a status quo. So anything that is status quo is, I understand that as a form of patriarchy. So that's one. And the other thing you said about toxic and benign, yes, there is toxic patriarchy. Of course there is. I mean, there is the blanket patriarchy where don't do this and don't do that. And I mean, the don'ts far outnumber and outweigh the do's. So yes, there is a benign and toxic patriarchy. As I'm sure there can be a benign and a toxic patriarchy as well. because the matrilineal lines that we know in India are about property, for example. Property passing from mother to father, which does not for a minute mean that there is more freedom in a real sense. Freedom to marry, to move out of that system should you want to. So the notion of freedom is also built into an understanding of patriarchy, free will.
The situation is already very complicated, as we all agree. May I give a very simplistic solution, which may sound naive, but you negotiate your space from where you are, which means wherever we are, in whatever complexity, we move from there. That's the first thing. And in our own space around us, you just be yourself, talk to the person next to you and explain yourself and take it from there. Otherwise, this labeling of, because I don't think I'm just a feminist. I have a masculine part to me and a female part to me in the way I deal with different situations. So from time to time, we are just doing this. If we were just to be ourselves in whichever situation we are, I think, and I believe, because I've lived that kind of life, it will be very simple. Then, who is society? Moves from who we are, and the circle gets wider and wider and less complicated. I don't know if it's too simplistic, but that's my sense.
Thank you, Sathya, and thank you, Rakhshanda.